Hey guys, I have to talk kind of low because I'm in my backyard and there are some very noisy little animals on the other side of the fence. And if they get wind of it, they'll hear and start participating in the conversation. But have you ever thought about the fact that maybe the person you're trying to hold on to, maybe the best thing for them is to let them go and to allow them to hit rock bottom and move forward with your life? Have you ever thought about that? Stay right there. I'll be back and we'll talk about it.
Let's talk. You don't know how to be an individual.
And we want to get back to our discussion on race relations in the United States. Pastor R.C. Blakes, Jr. joins us.
And as leaders on a local level, when we begin to combat the rhetoric with truth.
Pastor, thank you so much for joining me. It's such a terrific conversation that we even have to be having. What are you hearing from?
Let's talk with R.C. Blakes, Jr.
Let's talk. I was just sitting here and thinking about how many people's lives are, and I'm whispering again because I'm trying not to awaken these dogs on the other side of the fence, but how many people's lives are shipwrecked because they've anchored themselves to people who are dragging them down. And it kind of reminds me of the story of Jonah. If you're a Bible reader, with the story of Jonah, God told Jonah to go to one place. Jonah rebelled and decided to go to another and got on a ship. And as they were sailing, a storm arose. And they were carrying all kinds of precious cargo and things that would have benefited people. And they had to throw it overboard because of the storm. And then, long story short, finally they realized that the storm was raging because somebody offended God. And they realized it was Jonah. But then the Bible says something even more interesting. It says they rowed even harder against the storm, realizing at this point that it's not the storm they're fighting, it's God they're fighting, and God has an issue with Jonah. They didn't want to let go of Jonah and put their own lives in peril or at risk. And then finally, they threw Jonah over and everything calmed. Could it be that you have a Jonah in your life right now that you're trying to hold on to, and the reality is that the best thing for him or her is that you simply release them and let them go? Sometimes rock bottom is the very position the people in our lives actually need. You know, I've been doing this study on the narcissist, and you can't really do that study without coming in contact with the exact opposite, the empath. And I believe a lot of us are empaths and don't even realize it. And again, I'm no psychologist or therapist. I'm just a man that's trying to figure life out a little bit. And as I learn, I kind of have this conversation. But the empath is a person that's the exact opposite of the narcissist. They feel everybody's feeling. They put themselves in everybody's shoes. And sometimes they are so feeling and so concerning and so concerned that they go overboard to the point of self-destruction for the preservation of others. And the Bible says in Psalm 15 and 4 that there's one that will swear even to his own hurt, even when he realizes that he's in a lose situation. He will allow himself to be injured for the sake of pleasing or satisfying another. And there are many of us who are in that position with our children, with our parents, with our dysfunctional spouses, with boyfriends, with girlfriends, with coworkers, with church members, with people in the neighborhood. You're trying to hold on to people that are begging to be released. They need to be released. There's a story, there's a parable actually in the Bible. And it's found in Luke chapter 15. And it's very famous and popular parable. It's the parable of the prodigal son. And I believe we learn a lot there about how necessary it is to release a person for them to have the potential of finding themselves. The parable goes, or the story goes like this. The son, who's the son of a wealthy man and is living a life of affluence and influence and luxury, comes to his father and says, I want out of all of this luxury. I want out of all of this you've provided. And I want to go somewhere else. And the interesting thing is that the father, at least the Bible does not record the father trying to talk him out of it. The Bible does not record that the father even struggles with it. The Bible just kind of indicates that his father makes provision and he allows him to leave. Point number one, the father loved himself as well as loved as well as he loved his son. The father loved himself as well as his son. You must never love another to the extent, these are just notes I jotted. You must never love another to the extent you cannot or do not love yourself. If a person wants to leave you, doesn't matter how much you love them, you have to love yourself enough to let them go. Because to attempt to hold on to a person that is begging to leave is the destruction of one's own soul. So we see in the father's behavior with the son that the father loved himself at least as much as he loved the son. And we know that he loved the son because the Bible says once he, and I'm getting ahead of the story, but once he let him go, he looked for him. He was waiting on him. You know, he loved him. It hurt his heart to let him go. But the father realized that he had to let him go, and he loved himself enough to let him go. There are some of you that are watching me right now who are struggling with letting someone go, who's even asked to go, but you won't let them go, and you're not realizing that that is an indication of a lack of self-love. When you love yourself, you release people that do not want you. No matter how much it hurts, it does not hurt as much as holding on to someone who does not want you and allowing them to continuously, perpetually, consistently destroy your soul. The Bible says in Matthew 22 and 39 that we ought to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. In other words, self-love is the foundation for community love. I can't really love my neighbor properly or in a healthy way until I love myself. And there are many of you who are engaging in relationships before you've developed a complete love for yourself, which is a very dangerous dynamic. The second thing we see when you read the account in Luke 15 of the prodigal son and his father, the father allowed him to do what he wanted to do. He said, I want to go and I want to leave here. And the father said, so be it. He allowed him to do what he wanted to do. And there comes a point in time that you have to let people do what they want to do. You cannot hold them back. In fact, the father empowered him. The Bible says that the father divided unto him his wealth and gave him the money to go. He let him do what he wanted to do, and he empowered him to disconnect. You can do what you want to do. You just can't do it with me. So I will even empower you to go and do what it is you think you want to do. There comes a time in your life when you have to face the fact that everyone is an individual. And when you get to the point where you're trying to twist a person's arm in a relationship, you're trying to twist them out of their individuality, you then become the dysfunctional one. when a person says, I want to do X, Y, Z, and it does not include you, you should release them to do what they want to do, and you should have enough self-love, if you need to even empower them to get away from you, that they may be able to do what it is they want to do. If a person continues to cheat on you, they're saying to you, I don't want to be in this relationship. At least I don't want to be in it, not within the parameters of the covenant of marriage. If you're willing to have some open relationship, I'll do that possibly. But if you're not willing to do that, every time they cheat on you, they're saying to you, I don't want to be here. Why are you holding on? Why are you trying to hold on to a person that's constantly telling you, this is not where I want to be? When, if you look in Genesis 13 and 8, somewhere around verse 8, Lot and Abram, they come into this land of plenty, and Lot's men and Abram's men start fighting. And then Abram finally realizes and says, hey, let's not have all of this tension. You take whatever part you want of the land, and I'll take my part. You go your way, I'll go mine. Sometimes you have to empower a person to just get out of my life. You bring in so much drama and unnecessary tension. Just get out of my life. But there's some of you who are holding on to somebody who needs to be let go. Number three. Once the boy got out there and he left his father's home, the Bible says, it indicates that he spent the money that he had gotten rather quickly. He didn't invest anything, seemingly, because he was broke. He got broke rather quickly, living riotously. And the Bible says he began to be in want. And he got to the point where he was a rich man's son, but he was in a hog pen, getting ready to eat the slop that the hogs were eating. And the record is that, the interesting thing is that if you look in the chapter that records this parable of the lost son, there's a lost coin that a woman sweeps for. There's a parable of a lost sheep that a shepherd goes to find. The woman sweeps for the coin, the shepherd goes to find the sheep, but the father never goes to search for the son. The third point is that you must not rescue them from the process. When you let someone go, don't rescue them from the process. Sometimes you're quite aware of what they're asking for and that they're not ready for it. But once they're out there, do not rescue them from the process. They need to embrace the fullness of the process. They need the whole experience. They need to feel all of the pain. They need to go through all of the hardship. I was at my last child who's graduated from high school, going off to college. I was at his senior dinner the other night, and one of the faculty members got up and she said, I pray for you kids, you graduating seniors, I pray for you to have hardship. I pray for life in some ways to be hard. And she explained not hardship in the sense of suffering or struggling, but hardship in the sense of embracing the realities of life, that no one is entitled, that nothing is guaranteed, and that you get nothing that you do not work for, and that you have to embrace life, the good, the bad, and the ugly, the sunshine and the rain. But how many folk are in their seasons of rain and they have an empath that rescues them from the process before they've learned the lessons? I'm sitting in my backyard, and sometimes you come here and you see butterflies. Well, before butterflies, a butterfly, it's a caterpillar. And it's a caterpillar that crawls up on a tree, gets up on a leaf, under a leaf, and webs itself into a thing called a cocoon. After a certain period of development, evolution, inside of that cocoon, the caterpillar grows wings, and it begins to press against the walls of that cocoon. That cocoon begins to feel, I suppose, much like a tomb or grave. And the wings are there, and it's pressing against the walls of that cocoon. And some say if one were to slit the cocoon open and release developing butterfly before it went through the complete process, it would not have the strength to fly and would die. How many of us are cutting the cocoon open before the development process has completed? When you release them, do not rescue them from the process. Psalm 119 and 71 says, "It's good that I've been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes." There's some people that you have to release and just let them marinate in the process. It's good for them to learn. Sometimes you never reconnect with them, but they'll be a better person for the next individual. But their improvement starts with you having the strength and enough self-love to let them go and not rescue them from the process. And then number four, and I'm done, just kind of jotted on this paper here. In the prodigal son story in Luke 15, the boy, the Bible says, sitting in that hog pen, begins to think back on his life with his father. And now he's thinking about the condition he's in now by his own doing. And he says to himself, "My father has servants that are doing better than I'm doing." The Bible says he came to himself. He says, "I'm going to get up from here and I'm going to go back to where I belong. But I'm not going back with a spirit of entitlement. I'm not going back as a son. I'm going back as a servant. I'm going to ask my father to make me one of your hired servants. And I just want to work for him." And he got up and he made his way back. And the Bible says when he got close to his home, well, far away off actually from his home, that his father saw him, which indicates to me that his father had been hoping and praying and wishing for him to come back. His father saw him, and the Bible says he ran to him. And he said, his son said to his father, "I'm not worthy to be called your son. I just want to be a servant." And when his father heard the adjustment in his mindset and his maturation, his maturity, he said, "Bring me a robe, bring me a ring, kill a fatted calf. My son, which was lost, is now found." It wasn't that his body was lost, it was that his mind was lost. And his father knew that he couldn't hold on to him because his mind had already exited. So he had to let him go so he could recollect his sanity, his soundness of thinking, his soundness of thought. And finally, when he came to himself, his father received him again. Sometimes you have to let a person hit rock bottom and they'll come to themselves and they'll come back. And it's then that you exercise the power of forgiveness and unconditional love. Now, let me add this to bring balance. Everybody that you release and returns is not necessarily to come back into the same place in your life that they left. The Bible does say in Luke 17:3-4, that if your brother trespass, forgive him. And if he messes up so many times, forgive him as many times. But forgiving does not necessarily mean that you restore an individual to the same place in your life, but you receive them lovingly and you embrace them and you restore them. I think the book of Galatians talks about that. Restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. But there are some people that we have to let go for them to find themselves. And sometimes as you're trying to hold on to someone else, you're actually losing yourself. So I hope that this has spoken to you and helped you today. If this is your kind of thing, I'd love for you to subscribe. And I'd love for you to hit the little bell so that you'll know when I'm on or when I've uploaded. I'd love for you to like this and I'd love for you to share it. Give me your comments. Tell me what you think about. Maybe you're in a situation like this. Tell me what you think about it. You can email Lisa and or I at pastorrcblakes@gmail.com. Check out my website at rcblakes.com. Pick up on some of my books and what have you. And just generally let me know what you think about what I'm doing here. But remember this, sometimes trying to hold on to someone else is to lose yourself. Let them go. Rock bottom. has been a wonderful place for many people. The return from that experience has proven to produce many a great men and great women. Well, again, I'm R.C. Blakes, and remember this, you're on top and you're going higher. We got through without the dogs. God has more in store for you. God bless you. I'll talk to you next time.
Talk book.
A lot of you whose ignorance has been shattered.